رسوله الكريم أما بعد يوشك الأمم أن تداعى عليكم أي تايم ويلكم إن ماي أمة ويباتل ويل ميك يو pieces and morsels of food, and wherever you are in the globe, they will consume you. Hubb al-Dunya, one of the topics which you stipulated on Saturday was with regards to this Hubb al-Dunya, this deception of Dunya. When a believer attaches himself to Dunya, he prioritizes dunya, he focuses all his energy and potential on dunya. كونوا من أبناء الآخرة ولا تكونوا من أبناء الدنيا. Be of the people of آخرة, don't be of the people of dunya. These are all warnings from جناب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وساد القبيلة تفاسقهم, and the فساق, the فجار, the wicked people, evil people will become leaders. وكان زعيم القوم أرض لهم, and the leaders of that time would be the most despicable, the most wretched, the worst. If we look how the Muslim Ummah, and if we had to analyze generally, we could say other nations, other nationalities, but on a global scale, whether it's an entire country-wise or in a country where oppression with regards to physical harm, oppression with regards to laws is being meted out on the Muslim Ummah. And these Fusaq and Fujar leaders are part of this Umam, this group of Batil. On September 11, 1990, George H.W. Bush, after invading Iraq, said, "We stand today a unique and extraordinary movement. The crisis in the Persian Gulf, as grave as it is, also offers a rare opportunity to move forward an historic period of cooperation. Out of these troubled times, our fifth objective, a new world order, can emerge. A new era, freer from the threat of terror, stronger in the pursuit of justice and more secure in the quest for peace. An era in which the nations of the world, east and west, north and south, can prosper and live in harmony. 100 generations have searched for this elusive path to peace, while 1,000 wars rage across the span of human endeavor. Today, that new world is struggling to be born, a world quite different from the one we've known." At this very moment, they serve together with Arabs, Europeans, Asians and Africans in defense of the principle and dream of a world new order. Go back 1967 October, Richard M. Nixon. "The developing coherence of Asian regional thinking is reflected in a disposition to consider problems and loyalties in regional terms and to evolve regional approaches to development needs and to the evolution of the new world order." Going after that in the 80s, Mikhail Gorbachev, 1988. "Further global progress is now possible only through a quest for universal consensus in the movement towards a new world order." So their focus, their effort, their energies, all their efforts are made in the direction to enslave mankind, to bring humanity onto this year. And there's different efforts that have been made. But nowadays the concern is what is happening and what's the situation. Now let's move to the Vice Foreign Minister Wang Yi of China when he addressed the annual NATO Defense Ministers in the Bavarian city, and he represented the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, and he said it's the new security concept necessary to guarantee peace and stability and to fight against terrorism. His words were, China is ready to strengthen its coordination in cooperation with all other countries in the conduct of international affairs, security included, and work vigorously to a world that enjoys lasting peace and universal prosperity with a fair and equitable new international order. Then, 14 years down the line from that speech, 2016, when the speech was given again, as the Communist China prepares to host and to lead the group, the G20, the regime boasting its leading role in global economic governance, building up international order, bringing together the world's 20 most powerful governments and dictatorships to plot humanity's future. The Chinese Communist Party leaders and propaganda organs have been celebrating the emerging New World Order and their major role within it. The regime also vowed to work with other G20 members to develop policies that will steer the world economy into the future, towards a green global economy under the United Nations Agenda 2030 Plan for Humanity. Let us note this 2030 Plan for Humanity. And in 2016, China told its leaders, the President Xi Jinping, has called on Russia to join in forming the New World Order, dominated by both countries that he expects to realize in the next 10 years. He said the world is on the verge of a radical change. So, Europe and USA at their peak, they had their climax, but they don't put their eggs in one basket. And a country that doesn't have any religion, a country that the people are ready to be instructed like robots and follow instructions, a country which you can dominate. Likewise, a country that's filled with a lot of guns and ammunition, then that country is at great risk and turmoil. So certain laws need to be implemented prior to causing a crash in that system. So that needs a lot of planning, it needs a lot of tact, and that planning is already put in place and the ball is already in motion. If Allah gives us tawfiq, we'll mention a few points with regards to that. The point to understand in this whole issue is that China is the new global leader for the new world order. And they are preparing China in every aspect. I'm going to divert from the topic, but just considering China and the plotting of Batil, if we go and search CERN, so the logo of CERN is a 666, and that's the world's particle smasher. It goes under LHC, where it's a Large Hadron Collider. What does it entail is, it's an accelerator where they have high energy particle beams and they travel close to the speed of light. These particles then collide. The beams now travel in opposite direction in separate beams, and they are kept in ultra-high vacuum tubes. The accelerator guides these particles, and there's a magnetic field with superconducting electromagnets. We can go into detail and study what it's all about. But the current one that is built now in the world, in the Alps in Switzerland and France, bordering the two countries, there's a bigger one that's going to be built, and that bigger one is going to be 5 times more powerful than the current one. And it's expected to be 100 kilometer circumference. Imagine 100 kilometer circumference They say the biggest amount of technology on earth is at the current one now. Now their usuls, and this is on their website, to unite the people from all over the world to push frontiers of science and technology to benefit all. Then in Switzerland they launched a Gotthard-based tunnel in June 2016. And that was 57 kilometers, it was the longest railway, deepest traffic tunnel through the Alps. But the entire ceremony, the initial ceremony to promote, to launch, had one eye, it had ghosts, it had Satan and the goat, the head with the whole world following the Satan in this one eye. The whole ceremony is satanic. And if you go onto the LHC, you'll see that they also have done certain rituals of people in black cloaks doing certain rituals. Then outside CERN, they've got a statue of Shiva. Now, the scientists at CERN plan to summon Shiva, the source of all evil in Hinduism. Shiva is the great destroyer. His role is to bring the universe to an end and to obliterate all existence and give birth to a new entity. And some of their researchers are saying the force which gives particle physicists his powers. It is an energy field created by all living things. It surrounds us, penetrates us, it binds a galaxy together. Though researchers are not sure exactly what this force is, but students, professors in laboratories, now through CERN, they're trying to harness this power. And they're saying that practical applications will be long-distance communication, influencing minds, lifting things out of swamps. Means this aura, this force which is kept, this ruh, and connected to it. I'm not going to get into it in detail, but they want to expound and capture that energy and transfer that energy. And part of their saying is, may the force be with you. May the force be with you. We hope to continue, and in their words, we hope to continue to study the force and perhaps use it to open doors with our minds and fly around. Right now, the explanations are far from reality, but we plan to achieve it. So that is their target. So they are doing experiments on a global level, on a great big scale. And it's all connected to the Satanism and preparing the world for the coming of Dajjal. Preparing the world for the coming of Dajjal. And if you want to understand how their planning are and what their thought processes are, so there's a thing called chemtrails. So chemtrails was spraying, it was happening in the skies, people seen the planes and eventually they objected and they complained. And this was taking place in the USA, in Europe, countries in Asia, Japan, Korea. But there was no chemtrails in China. Why? Because they're keeping China groomed for the New World Order. Because China is going to replace the USA economically and militarily. So US is the thing of the past. All focus is now being done in China. And these chemtrails was to reduce people's immunity so that they will have pneumonia, respiratory symptoms. So people who have strong immunity, their immunity system would get weaker and weaker and weaker. And some researchers, investigative journalists, did some research on the air and they found that firstly, these chemtrails, these planes that were flying over and spraying chemicals were in altitudes and conditions that people could not see. And the results in the air tested in a lab showed that there are high levels of barium and other toxic agents which are three times the level that it should not be. Well, these toxins in the air, and they are being sprayed in the air. That was the one type of planning and plotting. Then the other type of planning and plotting, and if we think so it's far-fetched, is if we have to look at fluoride. I'm just mentioning these random examples for us to understand the reality and veracity. And if we think so, COVID was bad, then this is just the beginning. It's a real reality. Effort has been made for many, many years, and planning has been done to the T. Now somebody will say, what's wrong with fluoride? But if we go back to the 1930s, Hitler's scientists did some experiments with fluoride, and they found that it will affect a human's resistance, his mind. So a person's brain becomes governed and he becomes more tamed. So the Nazis were putting these fluoride, mixing fluoride in drinking water in concentration camps to subdue the prisoners. Then they did repeated experiments after using the prisoners. Then eventually they realized that even our soldiers, to get them ready to die and to calm them down, we need to put certain chemicals into them. So if you look at sodium fluoride, it's a contamination of the environment which comes from coal combustion, pesticides, poisons, animal feeds, fertilizers, etc., in pharmaceutical products, anesthetics, vitamins, antidepressants, hypnotics, psychiatric drugs, military nerve gas. A German chemist who worked in a chemical company in the end of World War II testified that under Hitler, they decided to, part of their planning was on invasion of certain countries, they would achieve mass control of masses by water medication. Now, research shows fluoride damages the brain. You can research all of this here. It's listed about 100 chemicals where it causes neurotoxicity. Then it can lower the IQ. It affects the pineal gland. It affects the thyroid function. It damages bones. It causes arthritic symptoms. It causes bone cancer. It causes issues with the reproductive system. So if we see, and if we study also in the US in the 1940s, when they implemented the system of fluoride in the water, that was initially where they started to say that fluoride is very good and it's needed for the teeth and it is beneficial. And then after that, they highlighted the benefits in medicine, they highlighted the benefits in dentistry, in different fields. But if we study fluoride and all the data behind it, there's something we need to be worried about. So the people of Batin, Batil plan, innahum yakiduna kayda wa akidu kayda. The people of Iman are not laxed. They always one up. Their amal is their first plan. Their connection with Allah is their first plan. To link themselves with their Khaliq is their best plan. And secondly, is they do not get caught. لا يُلْدَخُ الْمُؤْمِنِ مِنْ جُحْرٍ وَاحِدٍ مَرْتَيْنَ. A believer is not caught by the same hole twice. We should not get caught in all these traps. We need to be vigilant. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the reality. مَنْ قَرَأَ سُورَةَ الدُّخَانِ فِي لَيْلَةٍ أَسْبَحَ يَسْتَغْفِرُ لَهُ سَبْعُونَ أَلْفَ مَلَكٍ. Whoever reads Surah Dukhan every night, 70,000 farishtas, malaika, make istighfar for this person. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.